Who don't know what is workday, then we quickly share what is what we call power of one and focus more on our flagship product, Prism Analytics. Then since we're in Apache conference, we will tell how Apache Spark fits into this endeavor and what custom things we do with Spark, and especially focus on the upgrade from version to version. And then tell what we did in terms of runtime metrics pipeline. And if we have some time, we will share some of our future plans. So without further ado, workday in numbers. So several years ago, we used to joke that workday is one of the biggest software cloud companies you never heard of. And things change. Most people already heard about workday. When you look around this conference, you see many our companies who are our customers. So Workday is not that known as Apple, Google, Netflix, Facebook, and many others, but or maybe some more traditional companies like Bank of America and others. But many of those are our customers, actually. So people who work in these companies, they do know. This year, the previous year, the revenue was $3.6 billion. This year, even in spite of pandemic, it's growing still. And we will reach probably $4 billion. The growth has not been as fast as we would like, but we're still growing at 25-30% a year. Very impressive, knowing that even during this time, because people understand that cloud is the future, and we deliver a lot of stuff which previously was not available in cloud. We have a suite of about 30 products. If you took take a look together, more than 7,000 customers and growing. Very impressive, more than 40%, 45% of Fortune 500, 12,000 employees. Our areas are human capital management, financials, and more. But it's not about just like a lot of different products. The biggest message is all of them work together using power of one. You start with planning, you do financials, human capital, you analyze the data and extend. And everything is pre-integrated and shares the same foundation. That's the power of Workday. If you look from a technology standpoint, the secret is that we use the same platform. One platform which rules them all, one source of data, one security model, one experience, one community. And a lot of infrastructure things, including those we will discuss, they are shared across multiple applications. It makes it easy to develop. It makes them work in unison. It makes it easy for customers to use different applications in different areas of the products without having additional learning. So works very nice together. The core object data model Workday actually was developed many years ago, way, way ahead of the time. At the time when three-tier architecture was the state of the art, Workday went to the what we would call today memory-centric graph-based memory database with object-oriented features. I know it's a mouthful. But the idea is that it's backed by database in the bottom, but most of the thing is like graph, so graph with objects. So it's very extensible. That's why it's like much easier to add new application and new functionality. And it has both the data and metadata. Metadata more important actually here, because traditionally enterprise applications have been much, much more configurable and extensible than cloud applications. And because you actually share this in cloud with thousands of customers. So if you look at the most existing cloud application, they are not really configurable or extensible at the same time as traditional applications. So Workday has been able to actually to bridge this gap and make it very extensible and configurable, which represents a challenge, of course. And one of these challenges is security. People trust Workday with the most confidential and most sensitive data, personal data, financial data, payrolls, social securities, you name it. And of course, everything is encrypted, and we have multiple layers of security, and it's shared. And we actually extend the Workday traditional security into Hadoop and Spark, so to have the same one platform. And both Aaron and me, we work for the area which called the Workday Analytics. So it covers both traditional reporting with dashboard reports, extractions, integration, etc., and analytics, where we actually have modern ways to do exploratory analysis using drag and drop and interface, which can you can do stuff like modern analytical tools. More recently, we added augmented analytics using machine learning. So pretty much state of the art. And it works. How we know it works? Because every year we do the review and the survey, and we ask our customers about satisfaction across multiple dimensions, and we calculate the score. And we target a very high score of 95%. And for 4 years I've been in Workday, we've beaten this score every time. So last year, it was 97%. We beat it again. And not a small feat when you talk about very demanding, very big customers. So when you talk about customer, Fortune 500 customers, usually the company with tens or hundreds of thousands of employees. And we also have companies with dozens of employees as our customers. Maybe it's easy to run them, but no, thousands of customers and tens of millions of workers on this platform. Everything is cloud, no on-prem installation. I can talk a lot about all these products, but in this talk, we are going to focus on analytics. And, you know, when you have your human resource data and payroll and benefits and your financial data and supplies, etc., there is a lot of things you can analyze. Interesting stuff, as you become the center of your enterprise data for these areas, the law of data gravity, coined by internet visionary Dave McCrory, the late data gravity law, starts kick-ins. And what happens that people actually see that, oh, I can actually bring additional data to Workday, external HR, legacy HR, or maybe CRM. We have a lot of good partnerships with Salesforce and ServiceNow data and the third-party HR system, maybe in different countries, so on and so on. And from being the transactional, pure transactional system to manage your HCM and financial data, Workday becomes more like a data hub to analytics. And that's where actually Prism Analytics plays the role. Why we call it Prism? Because we allow to analyze the full spectrum of data, both Workday data and external data in Workday from different angles and get the insights. So Workday found that actually the interest to analytics is much higher than originally anybody thought. And then at this point, you should say, show me the money. You know, you've been talking a lot. Show me the money. And if you want one more number, the number is 500. In 3 years since we launched Prism Analytics, we went to 500 customers from zero. And this year was fantastic. Our growth was 100% year over year. So faster than any other product in Workday. And we're also introducing new analytical products. Then you would ask, like, okay, what's your secret? And now we're talking about secrets, right? The secret is that we actually follow the pretty traditional blueprint for analytical products. Like that, if you look here, like don't need to read every word, but from the left to right, data acquisition, data preparation, some kind of building the lens, what we call our kind of cube-like structure, analytics using the query, mostly in-memory query. And everything uses Apache Spark. That's the big secret, that instead of using different stacks for every one of those functions, we use Apache Spark along the way. And of course, we run today on Yarn and Hadoop as a storage. And then multiple applications which run on top of that, people analytics and the accounting center and the financials, et cetera, et cetera. And this is the block diagram. But with hundreds of customers and several what we call tenant environments per tenant, we run more than thousands of the tenants across multiple data centers. This is the very simplified way to say like what is the tenant. So traditionally we have like one tenant, which is production tenant, where actually the real data lives, but also several other non-production tenants. For example, sandbox tenants, which people use for experiments, maybe for training, to try some new business process before they actually migrate to production. Implementation tenant, when they run some kind of project, for example, creating the new integrations on new reports. Of course, we have DR tenant, disaster recovery tenant, which is used for internally. And if things go very wrong and we need to switch over to disaster recovery, which continuously gets data synced from the production tenant. So multiple tenants per customer, and of course, hundreds of customers. And today we run it as a, if you like, as a tower or as a pillar. So on the top, the tenant, this like 12 years of Workday investment, and then Prism application server, and then Spark cluster per tenant today. So we actually run thousands of Spark clusters. In this case, it's one availability zone, so we share the same HDFS. So we have a lot of sharing on the storage layer, not much on the compute layer. But we share a lot of, the code is the same, Power of One, right? So this is an example to just to increase the complexity. So we have several data centers. So this one shows like several data centers in the United States, a couple of data centers in Europe. We have the arrows which represent potential disaster recovery failover. Every data center hosts multiple environments for production, non-production, engineering, sales, disaster recovery. Recently, we also started to host our tenants in AWS, recently, I mean like a couple of years ago, versus like 10 years ago, we've been working with AWS in the areas where for different reasons, we don't want to establish the new data center today, but we plan to do more and more. So think about thousands of Spark clusters and tenants spread across multiple availability zones and database. So if you look at the single Spark in single tenant, kind of like taking the one tower of previous picture and putting it here on the one page, you will see that on the left side, this circle represents the whole Workday tenant, including the object graph and security and machine learning, et cetera, et cetera. And then we connect Prism application server, which is Dockerized application, and it launches number of long-lived Spark processes on the Spark cluster, and also it on demand it launches some additional jobs for the data preparation and data acquisition. So in this case, the solid line represents a long-lived process, and the dotted line represents the dashed line represents more like jobs. So we need both long-lived jobs and on-demand jobs. And of course, everything is powered by Apache Spark. But this time, I hope I should convince you that Apache Spark is already plays a very important role. But to make it even more interesting, we don't just use Apache Spark as is. We write a lot of code on top of the Apache Spark. We write a lot of code inside Spark that we need to change. We change some stuff for security. We change a lot of stuff for serviceability because we run everything in cloud. We don't expose Spark to end customers. Actually, our UI converts the customer data and queries and data preparation into our code, and then they get converted into logical plans and physical plans and get compiled. So gets very complex. We need stability, full GCs and stuff like that might happen. We run a lot of stuff across on the same cluster, multiple Spark cluster and executors. So we share queries and builds, long-lived versus on-demand jobs. So we need latency, multi-tenancy, interactive performance. So we enhance Spark, we build our own Spark. And that actually represents additional area of complexity. And by now you should be asking the question. And the question is like, okay, with all the scale, complexity, and dependencies, how you manage the Spark version upgrades? Because traditionally we would use Toggle for the features, but how you use Toggle for the Spark when it's compiled everywhere, it changed, and stuff like that. So this is something that Aaron will take over and share our secrets. Your screen is preparing. Aaron, you're a little slow. Your internet is a little slow.
All right. Is it all right now?
I see the blue screen. I don't see that anything on the screen. Okay, now I see it.
Sure. All right.
If it's a little slow, maybe idle drive.
I can go first. If you need time, I can hand over to you. Sure. All right. Spark upgrade, introducing the challenge when dealing with the high number of tenants and long-running Spark applications. Also, when Postgres rollout and rollback is required. During previous Spark upgrades, we were using the previous approach by supporting the single Spark versions against our custom repo. But this approach didn't support the Postgres rollout, so we needed to enable next Spark version for the all our tenants at the same time. And it didn't support the rollback case. So if any failure happens, we needed to apply the hot patch. In the light of this, we needed to migrate to new approach by supporting the multiple Spark versions against our custom repo. With this approach, we can easily move from current Spark version to next and vice versa. Also, this upgrade module is not specific for the Spark upgrades, and it can be applied for the any internal and external API upgrades. When dealing with this kind of challenge. Currently, we maintain our custom Spark fork by extending the Spark open source repo and applying our custom patches on the top of them, such as removing the PII data from the application logs in order to obfuscate our logical and physical Spark pins. Also, additional optimization rules, such as collapse aggregates, and the large case statements optimizations. Extension for the physical plan in order to enable the correlation between the physical operators and the runtime metrics. Public REST API improvements to be able to query and aggregate the physical operation level metrics. Also, additional modules such as benchmark module to be able to run benchmark tests introduced new Spark patches by using the standard TPCH and custom queries. When supporting multiple Spark versions, Spark API divs basically creating the both compile time and runtime issues, such as invalid type as the compile time and no such method error as the runtime issues. To be able to catch Spark API diffs, we currently using our build pipeline by running the both unit and the integration test against the both Spark versions. Also, to be able to deal with this kind of issues, we currently using the Shim API. Shim API defining the single interface and implementation per Spark version. And it also defining the common function signatures to be able to deal between the both compile time and runtime issues against the both Spark versions. We currently compile against the current Spark version and selecting the runtime version by using the feature toggle. Feature toggle is a software development technique to enable and disable the feature at the runtime. In addition to runtime version selection, feature toggle also helping us integration of the performance test by the Spark version, as well as enabling the Spark version at the environment level. For example, just to enable next Spark version for the test environments and the current Spark version for the live environments. Also, on the right side, please find the sample boot script for the Spark and the Shim compile time and runtime version selections. After the new Spark version and the Shim API are ready, we will have the three phases. At the verification phase, we need to run automated regression test by running the unit and integration test pipelines. After that, we also need to run Spark benchmark pipeline against the both Spark versions. Also, we have the separate performance test pipeline for the full end-to-end coverage by covering the application, Spark, and Hadoop. in summary, we need to verify that there is no performance regression, either next Spark API level or end-to-end. After the verification phase is completed, we can move to progressive rollout phase. Why we need the progressive rollout? Because we don't want to enable next Spark version for the all our tenants at the same time. At this phase, we can enable the next Spark version or just a single internal tenants, and the duration basically 2 weeks. After the wave one is completed, we can move to wave two by enabling the next Spark version for our multiple tenants, and this tenants also internal at the moment, and the duration 2 weeks. And when the wave two is completed, we can move to wave three by enabling the next Spark version for all our tenants, and duration basically 4 weeks. And if we have any issues during the wave cycle, we can easily roll it to our current Spark version. After the wave three is completed, we can move to cleanup phase, and we don't need to create Spark version fork and the artifacts. Also, we already migrated next Spark version. At this level, there will be no because we already starting. This we also don't need to. The next topic is our runtime metrics pipeline. We will see the details of how we capture Spark application job stage task and SQL metrics at runtime, and how we get their values by running application and queries. When we submit a query, Spark SQL engine analyzing it first and optimizing it, and after that, generating the multiple physical plan. Spark SQL Engine cost model selecting the most performant physical plan and generating DAG. DAG is direct acyclic graph. It is split to multiple stage, and each stage split to multiple tasks. And these tasks are run by the executors on the top of the partitions. Currently, there is a one-to-one relationship between the number of tasks and number of partitions. During the query execution, Spark generating the application job, stage, task, executors, and the SQL metrics. And these metrics, at the end of the query execution, they will be visible on the Spark UI, REST APIs, and event logs. This is our high-level runtime metrics pipeline architecture. Our application server launching the three different applications, such as data acquisition, data preparation, and query engine. Each of them allocating the its own resources, and each of them generating the its own Spark event logs. And this the Spark event logs is written to HDFS. Spark history server just loading to these are the Spark event logs, resolving them, and exposing to Spark REST APIs for the application executors at the SQL level. And SQL is coming new at this level. Our stats application just consuming to this REST APIs and transforming to incoming nested JSON data to Hive tabular format and writing to our Hive tables. Currently, we have the one-to-one relationship between the Spark public APIs and our Hive tables. Executed query metrics are currently visible under SQL tab on Spark. At the Spark version 3.1 will be introducing the new two SQL endpoints, such as SQL and SQL by execution ID. In the light of this, we can also access Spark SQL metrics through REST. Recently, we integrated this SQL REST endpoint with our metrics pipeline. So currently, we can collect SQL metrics. We can easily run the query and aggregation on the top of that. This is just comparison of new Spark SQL REST API JSON outputs. Initially, we needed to cherry pick an older version from the Spark open source master branch, and we needed to improve it because we need to have the correlation between the physical operators and their runtime metrics. And Spark generating the single function at the end of the stage execution across the multiple physical operators. And at this level, whole stage code gen ID support also important across the multiple physical operators. And we also need to normalize incoming metric values to be able to run aggregations and the query on them. For example, if the metric values are coming as the gigabyte, megabyte, we are normalizing them to bytes, or if they are coming our minutes, we are normalizing to millisecond. In the light of this, we can easily run aggregation on the top of them. These are just sample aggregations and the queries we currently run on Spark SQL metrics. And in the light of this, we can easily create charts per query. For example, what is the total loaded number of input and output rows or number of files by tenant application or date? Or what is the mostly used operation by tenant application or date? Or what is the total number of joins, broadcast hash join or sort node join across to all tenants by date, and so on. We currently log physical plan in the application logs, and we integrated our physical plans with their physical operators and their runtime metrics. In the light of this, we currently have correlation between the physical operators and their runtime metrics from the application. This definitely help us for the troubleshooting and the debugging purposes. This pattern also introduced by the Spark 3.0, it is called as the formatted explain mode. These explained improvements were backported to Spark open source repo for the community usage. They will be available with Spark 3.1. In the light of this, you can easily build your runtime metrics pipeline. And you can find the further details through this error. The next topic will be the what is the next. Currently, Spark 3.0 introduced the new features such as adaptive query execution. Adaptive query execution supports the dynamic query optimization during query execution based on the runtime metrics. By collapsing the shuffle partitions, default number 200 during the query execution, and selecting the more accurate and efficient join type between the broadcast hash join versus sort node join, and also detecting the data sensitive on join operations. These are very important because this kind of issues also are well-known Spark level issues, and Spark 3.0 basically introduced the very important the improvements at this level. And also, the introduced the dynamic partition pruning. It is also another important feature to partitions during the query execution. Until the 3.0, we already have the join hints for the just the broadcast hash join, but the 3.0 also introduced the new join hints broadcast hash join, such as sort node join, shuffle hash join, and Cartesian joins, in order to force the join time. Another feature is that ANSI SQL compliance. It is the currently experimental, and it is also important to align with the other engines. Another feature, new native Prometheus sync. It is also useful to capture Spark driver and executor metrics, and recently we built our NIF monitoring pipeline on the top of it. And the another feature, the NIF Scala 2.12, JDK 11, and the Hadoop 3 support. Able to get this introduced feature benefits, we are planning to migrate Spark 3.2. In parallel, currently we are also working to upgrade Scala 2.12 and Hadoop 3. We also plan to invest more effort on performance troubleshooting and debugging improvements. And I am just hands over to Pavel at this level.
Yeah, and it would be probably more than enough for the single session, but you know, in the best traditions of the late Steve Jobs, like we wanted to say, like one more thing, always wanted to do that. Next slide. So as you said, we already have multi-tenancy in our data centers. We effectively share a lot of storage and some underlying systems, et cetera, et cetera. But when it comes to the Spark, we run the Spark cluster per tenant, which has a lot of advantages. Isolation, ease of debugging, you can independently scale per tenant, et cetera. But analytics is not the steady application. The usage comes in spikes. A lot of times some tenants are idle, especially at night, you know, in some smaller companies. In multinationals, it differs. You know, some non-production tenants may be less busy than other tenants. So, but we have to provision the capacity based on the peak usage or close to the peak usage. And also, what about the seamless upgrade? If you want to do that, you need to actually to have like a lot of additional capacity to do that. So that's why we have been working for a number of months for the new project we call Multiverse. Next slide, please. And the Multiverse actually takes the multi-tenancy and Spark to the next level. So I still don't see the next slide. So some delay, and we'll try to. So you see, like, currently we run a lot of Spark clusters using Yarn, Hadoop, and where we are going next is to actually have the Workday tenants to be connected to two or more Prism application servers, and each one connects to the larger Spark cluster. In the previous one, you saw the discolored pictures, which would say like the data for this particular tenant, for example, the red, the pink, yellow, blue belongs to that. And then the Spark cluster was homogeneous in terms that it served the specific tenant. Now the Spark cluster will serve multiple tenants. So we're taking the multi-tenancy to the whole new level. Not just the Spark cluster. Multiple tenants can send and route their request to multiple Spark cluster transparently for the application layer. So that provides additional ability to scale up as needed, and also takes us to the holy grail of upgrades, rolling restart with zero downtime, something which was reserved to only best of the breed the products like Apache Cassandra. So we take it into the Spark level. And additionally, it also has the challenges. What about fair usage? How you prevent cannibalization of some resources by hungry jobs, etc. So how you make sure that things are totally transparent to all applications based on top of that. And we are looking into Kubernetes to be able to leverage some new features there. So sounds very interesting and challenging. And as you probably know, we are hiring, we are growing. So search for day jobs on Google and come and please apply. There is a lot of stuff to be done. Happy to work together with you. Yes. So, and I guess like we have a couple of minutes for questions. So the question from Patrick, do you have to implement role-based data access rights to get that work? And of course, yes. And actually much more. Not sure I have time to talk about this, the security, for the security in several minutes. And Kubernetes, right? The short version, we have, of course, domains and groups and roles and combination, all of that. And we extended into Spark and Hadoop using the Kerberos and Hadoop security and Spark security using on top of Hadoop. And then we are going to use the Kubernetes. When we migrate to Kubernetes, we are going to use the Kubernetes primitive. So we will not reinvent the wheel, but actually extend Workday security, the one security model, into the infrastructure based using the right paradigms. Can you please share your slides? Yes, we will do. We will put our slides on a SlideShare. Shameless plug, there are a number of other presentations we did at Spark Summit and other presentation. I did a couple of them, and the other members of the team did more. So a lot of stuff which we couldn't mention this time on the SlideShare. So search for Workday Spark, you will find it. So you would like to take next one about Shim APIs, Aaron?
Yes. Currently we are applying the Shim API just for the Spark level, the API divs. And for the cross-version conf, level dependency versions by enabling them to level also. And we also have the Spark level class path, isolated class path at the moment. But one of the important points for the shim layer, it means you're basically supporting to multiple Spark versions against your single repo. This means your test should be the high level, and it should be very robust to catch both compile time and runtime issues at the build time.
Any tools to manage your Spark pipelines in a GUI way, and like Apache Nephi. So we do use the tools, the UI, which we developed at Workday. So so if you like to see like some ideas again, like please go to other presentations on the SlideShare or Spark Summit site. There are some screenshots, but the idea is like our customers happen to be not developers, or most of them are not PhDs like doing analytics. Those are people who are financial analytics, HR analytics, managers, HR partners. Most of them don't know Spark, and they don't even know that Spark actually powers this application. So we have much more enterprise-like or consumer-like UI tools, so that they create these pipelines, and then our software converts them to Spark. Interesting, it converts them to Spark to show the example, so they know what goes on. And also the same Spark code is used to actually to crunch this data and create what we call lenses, or based on the Parquet data format, which is used by queries. So Spark is used behind the scenes. We don't expose Spark in any way. Answer this one. So it's not like Apache Nephi, because Apache Nephi is actually focusing on a much more technical audience. Ours is much more intuitive and more generic. If you like closer to Informatica, business objects, and Tableau versus more like engineering tools. Do we have anything for our developers opposed to customers? So for developers, we don't have the tools to do pipelines, because the application which create pipelines use the same tools as our customers use, and then we package and ship them. For the developers, we do have tools. We do have tooling because we run Spark and some environments which, for example, we cannot access because of the privacy concerns. So we log a lot of stuff there, but we also sanitize the logs, so no personal information actually goes to our logs. We have a lot of audits on this case. But we also need to understand what goes on behind the scenes, because on the Spark level versus what actually customers is. So there are tools for debugging, for visibility, for monitoring, those tools, not tools to create the pipelines, because majority of them are customer done, and some of them we actually use the same tools. About the stops starts up, periodically polling us. Erin, can you please take it?
Yes, I am taking it. In the light of the ARP, we just supporting the currently about the running Spark application. Applications in the basically persistent application ID, job ID, stage, task, and the SQL ID on the Zookeeper at the moment. In the light of this, we try to basically avoid from the duplication, data duplication at this level. But we currently have the scalability issue on the Spark History server at the moment. So we basically trying to improve our scalability. And we also have basically planned improvements on this pipeline.
Nice. Okay, so the last question, what are you looking for the most of the future of Spark? So that's a very good question. So I noticed Spark when it was like very young, one of many computing frameworks on top of the Hadoop. You remember, let's say like circa 2013, 14, early 14, when everybody would do yet another computing framework on top of for the big data. Many of them are Hadoop, some not. So Spark didn't have the company behind it. A bunch of PhD students from Databricks. Databricks was not formed from some students from Berkeley running the meetup in the Bay Area. So I noticed this then, I've been following Spark since then. So nobody could predict the success so far and the huge amount of problems where it has become applicable. So today there is no second place, right? Like today, like everybody who bet on Spark and us, we have proven right with the time that that's the number one technology for data processing at scale. There is no distant second. So what is the next frontier? So machine learning a lot, but there is a lot of machine learning. I think the next big thing which we will do, like actually, in addition to incremental improvements in the Spark SQL and moving to Kubernetes, I think the next big thing is actually getting the transactional Spark into transactional applications, especially financials, something that reserved for databases with the strong transactional support. And Delta.io, which we recently adopted and use, and we didn't cover in this session, takes it closer to this area when we can use Spark to solve real-life financial accounting issues at scale for the largest customers in the world. So I would say, opinionated opinion. Okay, guys, I guess we are out of time. Thank you very much, and thank you for coming. Hope it was useful.
Thanks, folks.